Oh, thanks. I just learned what good game meant. When I was coming out, she said, I'll let you know. I'll give you the good game sign. That's a joke. I'm sorry. I know I'm not supposed to have humor on these things. I'll tell you, it's a privilege and honor to be back here again. 2 years ago, I was here, then as the director of NSA. It's good to come here. I got promoted shortly after being here. And so when they asked me, do you want to come again? I said, absolutely. I'll tell you that last time we talked a little bit about NSA, transparency, the Comprehensive National Cyber Initiative, and I stressed teamwork. And I'll tell you, the real reason that I came back here and that we have members from both the National Security Agency and Cyber Command and from throughout the government is securing our nation's network is a team sport. We all have to work together to make this happen. We need your help. And so what I want to do today is talk about a few things. I'm going to cover a little bit about the threat, a little bit about what's going on in the networks. I want to talk about the DepSec Def and his speech, hit a few points, and then I'm going to concentrate on the two things shown here, the active defense and what that means for us, and what we need to do to expand that, and perhaps some concepts for a secure zone. So with that, let's move to the next one. You know, this has been a great couple years when you look at what's going on with all the technology that's out there. Think about all the things that have happened just in 2 years. You know, the iPads, right? iPhones, Android, all these new tools that are coming out. It's phenomenal. The rate of change is huge. It's exploding. In fact, the acceleration, that shift, has been significant for us, for our networks, for everything that's going on. Think of this. In 2010, there were 107 trillion emails sent. 294 billion of those each day. 89% of those were spam. That's the ones I got. I have 4 daughters and 13 grandchildren. I know I don't look that old. They use the network. I think we account for 80% of that. 35 billion tweets last year, and I know the section coming up after me, you're going to be able to tweet into them, so we'll raise that limit for next year. And 72% of U.S. users in the U.S. users are on Facebook, and Facebook recently went over 600 million participants, 600 million. If that was a country, that's the third largest country in the world, netizens, if you will. Now think about this in terms of what that means for the changes that are going on in the network and what we can do with it. What will be our future? It took 2 centuries to fill up the Library of Congress. I know I see there's a Navy guy sitting right here. He's going to say, it took longer to teach the Army to read. Well, that's true. Okay, so he's one of my guys too. 29 million books in the Library of Congress. 2.4 million recordings, 4.8 million maps, 57 million manuscripts, and today on the network, 5 minutes, we'd fill that up in 5 minutes. It's huge. And if you went back to 2000, to the year 2000, the average user had about 0.25 gigabyte of storage. Today, 128 gigabytes. And by 2020, we estimate 131 terabytes. That's huge. Now, I wanted to hit a little bit on Deep Blue and Watson. Many of you saw that, right? Yesterday? No, you were at the party. Okay. But if you had seen it, Deep Blue, 1996, Garry Kasparov won. The next year, they made some changes, Deep Blue won. That was the first change when people said, we'll never be able to build a computer that can beat one of the grandmasters in chess, yet it happened. Now in Jeopardy, we thought there is no way with the natural language problems that machines would have that we'd ever have anybody that could beat Ken and Brad. We'd never come up with a machine. If you watch that, the natural language processing, the way it answered questions, the opportunities for the future, it's huge. absolutely huge. You know, there are tremendous opportunities with what's going on, with what we're creating, and tremendous vulnerabilities. So I wanted to talk a little bit about this because, you know, it was the first time that we organized a snowball fight in Washington, D.C. I'm glad it was just snowballs. And if you go and now look at what happened in Egypt, we use social network, they use social network, snowball fights, changing the government and the way things that are happening. It's a wave of the future. The capabilities that we are making are changing that future. We, all the folks here, are helping to make that happen. You know, and it's not just the rate of change, but that shift of change that's going on. And so one of the key things that we have to do now is, how do we take this combined talent and figure out how we secure that network? Well, first, I had to get the Mallory in here just to show RSA that I could keep up with the changes of themes every year. Now, one of the things is I was showing this to some of my folks, and they said, that does not look as scary as you'd want. I said, okay, but we're going to work with this, and you know, there's some things we'll get it to morph, perhaps. But first, Deputy Secretary of Defense Lynn spoke on Tuesday. He gave you some thoughts. First, he and the President have both said that cyberspace is a national security problem, something that we've got to work. He talked about exploitation, disruption on the network, and destruction, and how that's morphing over time. Think about that. From the time prior to 2007, exploitation, and that continues today, the intellectual property that we're losing, the secrets that we're losing, everything that's happening on our networks, crime. Now, add to that, 2007, we had in Estonia, over the Tallinn Monument, an attack, a disruptive attack. And that disruptive attack was one where a distributed denial of service against the Estonian government by hacktivists in Russia. And then other attacks have occurred in Georgia, 2008, Latvia, Lithuania, Azerbaijan, Kyrgyzstan. I didn't even know some of those were countries until a few years ago. And they've all been hit with disruptive attacks. Here's the concern, destructive attacks. And I think the Deputy Secretary said, you know, here's the issue. There's never been a weapon that's been created that hasn't been used, and our concern that some of those tools will be used. Our networks. What I'm responsible for as the commander of U.S. Cyber Command is for securing the DoD networks, and there's about 15,000 networks that we have. We operate, we direct the operations and defense of those networks. They're scanned more than a million times a day. We have malicious email attacks on those networks over 20,000 times a month, and other attacks over 1,000 times a month on those networks alone. So it's a lot scarier than what you see here. So let's update that. There, that's better. So when you think about it, these are the problems that we're facing on the network. I did that for TJ. It's a Navy thing, right? When you think about the amount of data that we have on the networks for the Defense Department, we're scanning in and out of our networks 90 terabits of data, 150 billion packets roughly every day. And so when you take into account what's happened in Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, and Georgia, we've got to secure our area. Now here's the issue. Two parts. The Department of Defense does not exist on an island by itself, and it's not there just to protect the Department of Defense. So we have a requirement and an obligation to support DHS and their mission, and I'll talk about that. But the biggest problem that we've seen, well, twofold. One, that infrastructure that we depend on, the power grid and the rest of the network, if it's not there, we cannot do our job. We have a responsibility to help make that happen. The defense industrial base, where our equipment is made, we've got to help secure. We've got to partner with industry to make that happen. And part of that came through crystal clear in 2008. 2008, what happened? Well, I think Secretary Lin pointed out, perhaps the biggest breach in our classified networks occurred because of this thumb drive with malware. No, it's actually thumb drives in general. It was a wake-up call. It also served as a catalyst and was the reason, the rationale that the Secretary of Defense said, we need to take the different parts of Cyber Command and put them together. And we need to change the conduct, our culture within the military, and our capabilities to defend our networks. As the DEF said, this is an important time. Most of the destructive tools are being developed. They haven't been used. We have an opportunity to go fix them. We have to develop stronger defenses, and we need to use this window of opportunity to take that on. So, what have we done? 2009, we established U.S. Cyber Command, and we took the components, Joint Task Force Global Network Ops, and the Joint Functional Capabilities Command Net Warfare, merged those two together. Okay, so we had two separate commands to build one command. That's a good thing, I think, because it brought all of our capabilities in DoD into one place, that we could operate seamlessly as one team, not two. And I think that's absolutely vital to our mission. I was dual-hatted as that, so you get a bargain. One commander, two jobs, one paycheck. I'm negotiating that part still. I'm just kidding, they wouldn't hear it. We went to our full operational capability the end of October 2010, signed off by Secretary Lin. We are now defending and operating the DoD networks as a team, and I think that partnership has allowed us to go further than ever before. Perhaps more important to you, the partnership with DHS is out there. We are changing our culture, conduct, and capability. And I would point out, President Obama approved the stand-up of the command and nominated me in this position. So, speaking of President Obama, I thought it was important to hit some of the key things that he said since the last time I was here. And this was in his 29 May 2009. First, he said, cyberspace is real, and there are risks that come with it. Cyber threat is one of the most serious economic and national security challenges we face as a nation. Protecting digital infrastructure is a national security priority. And then he laid out some components of the plan. First, a comprehensive strategy to secure America's information and communications networks. Second, work with all the key players. His comments were to me, help make this a team sport. So that's one of our missions. And that includes state and local governments, and perhaps most importantly, the private sector. Make this a team sport, work together. Strengthen that public-private partnership and continue to invest in cost-cutting edge technology. Get to the future, research and development, and a national campaign to promote cybersecurity awareness in digital literacy. And I'm going to talk about that when we get to the end, what we can do jointly to help push our schools and our educational systems in the science, technology, engineering, and math programs. So you had Deputy Secretary Lin come out, and he wrote this article in the September-October timeframe for foreign affairs. There were five key pillars in this article. First, and I think he briefly mentioned this, I want to hit a couple of those because it will set the stage for the rest of my discussion here on active defense and what we can do to help create a secure zone. First, he mentioned that cyberspace, he had these five pillars, and you see them on the right side of the screen. Cyberspace is a domain on parity with air, land, sea, and space. We must be able to operate and defend in that space. That's a requirement that we have. Second, the active defense. I'm going to spend a lot of time on the active defense, so I'll skip through that right now. But this is the key change that I see for the military networks and how we operate. We must also look at how we're going to protect critical infrastructure and key resources. We can't just protect our domain. We've got to partner with DHS, with industry and the private sector to develop our critical infrastructure and key resources. These global partnerships have got to go not only within the US, but to our allies. We can't do this alone as a country. It's one network, and on that network, we must partner. And I think one of the things that you here can really help us do, leverage our technical dominance. Look at what we've been able to create with the iPad, with all these devices that we have. Now, how do we take that, what we've created here, the internet, all those things, and now create a secure cyberspace for our future? So, I want to talk about the active defense and give you my thoughts on this. Characterization about how we in the military defended our networks was something analogous to the way you might look at defending pre-World War II. And I'm using this analogy to help highlight the fact that you can't have a static defense if the adversary is running all over. And so I use the Maginot Line in this picture. And as many of you know, in the Maginot Line, the French had built this very static defense up and felt that they would cover where they thought the Germans would come through, believing that the Ardennes force was impassable. That proved to be not true. And the consequences, everybody knows. Now, here's the analogy for us. We cannot build defense for our systems and just expect to statically build it and say, it's done, and expect that that will live there forever. It won't. Our systems will not be secure if we just apply a patch to it. We have to expand that throughout our system. That active defense has to have several attributes. We have to make it dynamic. And we have to tailor our capabilities specific for each network. And develop countermeasures that we can use to counter the adversary as they adapt and change, trying to get into this network. It's team-based, multiple systems and organizations working together. That means a couple things. First, how do we hunt inside our networks for adversarial capabilities, malware, if you will? How do we work on the boundaries? And what's the responsibility of the military and the intelligence community to provide early warning and indications about problems that are going to come to our network? We think we have a responsibility to do that. How do we do that? We're testing that with the military networks, but I think that's also something that we have to reach out to industry and partner in the same way. So that early warning and hunting will be a key part. So we've got to change from what I'll call a static defense. Don't get me wrong. I think our antivirus community is doing a great job. It really is. But it can't be just that. It's got to be full spectrum defense, and we've got to train our people to operate in that environment. Now, the second part, I wanted to see how many pictures. What I was told is the more pictures you get of your bosses in here, the more credit you get later. So I thought, well, I'll get everybody in. Wait till you see the line. No, I'm just kidding. So I have Secretary Gates and Secretary Napolitano on this slide for a couple of reasons. One, the partnership. In September of 2010, they sat down and signed a memorandum of agreement. Now, let's go back. Why did we put Cyber Command at NSA? And the answer was to leverage the technical foundation that NSA has. It's our nation's center of gravity for crypto mathematicians, for cryptanalysts, for linguists, for all that we need to operate in cyberspace. And many of you saw Dickie George and some of the capabilities that we have, what we've done to help ensure the security of our systems. We can't, in these budget environments, afford to replicate that, or duplicate that, or make copies of it. As a joke, I'm sorry. I'll go slower. So we should leverage it. And if it's good for us, Secretary Gates said, we've got to help DHS in the same way. So he and Secretary Napolitano sat down and wrote this memorandum of agreement. Four key points. First, it doesn't alter the authorities of either DOD or DHS. It says we're going to work together and leverage that platform. Rear Admiral Mike Brown is one of the DHS folks that have come up to NSA as part of the exchange program. I think he refers to it as the hostage exchange program. So we have a director of cybersecurity coordination, that's Rear Admiral Mike Brown. At DHS, we've sent a joint, we have a joint coordination element also up there, and we've taken elements from US Cyber Command and NSA and put them down at DHS. A first step on our partnership, a huge step forward. Now, part two, how are we gonna do the second part? How do we extend this secure zone, if you will? How do we help protect the critical infrastructure, key resources? That's a DHS mission. In fact, right now, the White House is leading that with participation from across the government. DOD, DHS, the intelligence community, Department of Justice, DOE, and others are working on that. So it's a team approach. And the intent would be, let's build how we can do this with DOD, show that we can extend that for the government, and then to key critical infrastructure, and do that. We're in the process of addressing those relationships now. I think we've made some great progress. It has to be a public-private relationship. I think the private industry is going to run most of that. We would provide sensitive signatures that we have. They would ensure that those sensitive signatures are carefully maintained and not given out so the adversary knows them. That would be key to it. And then the other thing is, how do we tip and cue problems that we see coming to that infrastructure? So this is a step in the right direction and a way of building that partnership. Now, one of the things, you know, immediately what people come to is, oh, civil liberties and privacy, cybersecurity, which is it? I don't think it's either one or the other, it's both. We want and we must demand to get both, and we can. In fact, one of the things that I would throw back to all of you, with the talent that we have here, what RSA stands for and what was done over 30 years ago that we could now do again is, how do we ensure the protection of our networks and the protection of our civil liberties and privacy? I think we can and must do both. And we need to stop these attacks from getting into our networks. I think we can do that. Now, what I wanted to do is to bring out a couple other points. And I chose this slide here. And in the middle, you see Grace Hopper. Some of you may have met her. She used to go around and brief with a wire, 30 centimeter wire, 1 nanosecond, right? And you know what this slide represents with all the folks we have on it from Gates, Steve Jobs, Sergey Brin, and Mark Zuckerberg? Innovation Nation, that's us. We're the folks that help put this together, this network. What Grace Hopper did, she joined the reserves in 1943. In 1944, she was assigned to the Bureau of Ships Computation Project at Harvard University. She worked on the Mark computer. In fact, she helped design COBOL, which would become the most widely used business language ever. There was one great thing. You know, there's, if you want a little piece of history, when she was working with one of her friends on the Mark II computer, the system shut down, a moth was in between two of the connectors. The guy reached over to take the moth out. She called that debugging, and that's where we are today. True story. That's the only thing I do know. Look at the talent that we have. to create all these great tools. I believe we have the talent to build a cyber secure capability that protects our civil liberties and privacy. So some thoughts. What we need, when we look at cyberspace, what are the issues that we face? If you were to look at it, one, how do you see cyberspace? We don't have situational awareness. If you think about it, how do you actually see your networks? We can't see the networks easily. We get readings back, but you can't see the networks like you do the physical domain. We need to fix that, especially for the military. We need to continue to refine the roles of government and the private sector in securing the nation's critical networks with this White House-led effort. We really got to push that. I think we need to create models, tests, simulations, and look at how we can evolve our defensive infrastructure. We need, with your help, to create a public demand for secure technology. Most of you know that that's a hard sell because if it doesn't come with the top line, it may not go into the product. We have to push that. Perhaps the most important thing that I see from my perspective, education, two parts. How do we educate the American people, including Congress, the administration, and others, on what really goes on in these networks? You folks here know more than anyone else what's happening. We've got to highlight that so we can go fix it as a team. We've got to integrate some of the capabilities into a responsive, agile, mutually supporting set of agreements that we can work between us, government, industry, and our allies, and figure that out. We lack in the military capacity. We don't have a cyber force. We have to create that. The Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine Corps are working hard with the service components to do that. That's something that we've got to push. I think our nation concurrently needs to push the STEM programs in our schools. When you look at it, we have to push science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. That's something that you can all help. Absolutely vital to our future. We cannot let the advantages that we've had in the past erode in the future, and I think it's with the STEM program. And I think, from my perspective, we've got to build the trust and confidence. So one of the big things that I get hit with is, what about transparency from NSA? So some of the stuff that we pushed here, and I think you've seen we've had a number of people in these different forums over the last few days, is the transparency to the maximum extent we can. We cannot divulge our nation's secrets. I think today, or over this week, many of you have seen that while it was greatly suspected that NSA had done things to some of that, that's proven not to be true. What we've done is tried to secure it, because our military and our nation uses some of this technology. We have to do it, and it's the right thing to do. It is a tremendous privilege and honor for me to serve as both the director of the National Security Agency and the commander of U.S. Cyber Command. We have great people. They are doing all they can to do their portion of the mission. With your help, I think we can take the next steps. This is a team sport. This team sport takes all of us, in government, in industry, with our allies, to fix our cyber security. We look forward to partnering with you. Thank you very much for this opportunity. It's been a great 30 minutes. Thanks, folks.